Welcome to The Nature of Things. I'm David Suzuki. Tonight we travel from our backyards around the globe to India and Europe. There's something of interest for everyone, from the world of nature to the engineering and architecture of cathedrals.
The Gothic Cathedral, it transforms stone into air and light. The miraculous tree of India, the neem tree. It will grow anywhere and has 1,001 uses. The bluebird. A few years ago, it had become an uncommon sight in Canada. Now, with the help of human landlords, it's back.
These towers of steel and metallic tinted glass are 20th century buildings. They've been designed with the aid of computers and have incorporated the latest in materials and construction technology. Like most great buildings, they soar into the sky and make stunning use of light. They look like they'll stand forever. Still, the underlying philosophy of architecture has scarcely changed over centuries. But 800 years ago, a band of skilled artisans set out on an unprecedented endeavor. Mostly illiterate and armed only with simple tools and rudimentary mathematics, they worked with glass and stone, and they succeeded in covering Europe with dazzling jewels of architecture, cathedrals of the High Gothic.
The medieval cathedral was far more than just a house of prayer. It embodied a great spiritual order, more real to the medieval mind than all the world of matter. The task was given to the builders, to imitate the divine architect himself. He, they believed, made all creation out of nothing, and they must recreate it all in stone. Today in Bedford, Indiana, the same stone is quarried for the same purpose. Limestone. It's soft enough to cut and carve, hard enough to survive the centuries. Limestone has been the raw material of countless monuments. Most of the great cathedrals were created out of it. More recently, the skyscrapers of New York City were faced with stone from this quarry. And it's still going to New York, this time to build the Cathedral of St. John the Divine. Started in 1892, St. John's is a Gothic cathedral that's still under construction, a witness to the lasting power of the Gothic to express religious faith. Thousands of stone blocks are quarried and cut, and then laboriously shaped by saws and chisels that treat the stone like timber. In St. John's Stone Yard, people and machines are involved in a lengthy collaboration. Cathedrals have always taken at least a generation to build. Limestone is called freestone because it can be cut freely in all directions without regard to grain. These apprentices will spend years learning how to handle it. It's the ancient craft of Freemasonry. 800 years ago, Masons were part of a revolution. They began to build higher, lighter structures than had ever been thought possible. They built lofty interiors filled with light out of delicate curved stone. It was an engineering marvel, and new techniques developed to analyze structures can help us understand it better. This Gothic shape was quite unlike its predecessors. Early in the 11th century, pilgrims climbed this hillside in southern France to see a new church in the village of Conques. It was built in the old Romanesque style that was soon to be superseded. The church of Saint-Foy reflects the stern faith that governed life and death for its builders. Swallowed up by hell, the damned receive ingenious punishments, while the blessed make their solemn way to their reward. The power of those saints in heaven could be tapped, it was thought, through the holy relics of the church. This is a reliquary made for the skull of Saint-Foy herself, a young girl martyred by the Romans 3 centuries after Christ. Like the patron saint, the arches of the church were derived from the Romans. Its structure is described by Princeton engineer Robert Mark.
I'm standing in the gallery above the side aisle of the Romanesque church at Conques. Romanesque churches typically have massive walls with relatively small window openings. They also generally have very heavy barrel vaults, which exert very large forces both downward and outward.
The outward thrust of the vault tends to push the walls apart. Huge amounts of heavy stone are needed in the gallery and side walls to counteract this thrust.
The system works well, but it has one great disadvantage. The light entering the upper reaches of the cathedral is indirect because it has to pass over the gallery, and it makes the interior of the church somewhat gloomy.
It's like a tunnel burdened with masonry. Outside, it's like a fortress, stone heaped up against its own weight. But within a few decades, stone had been set free from the rock pile and lifted high above the rooftops. The cathedral at Chartres was one of the first of the new Gothic structures. Instead of the massive walls of the Romanesque, vertical buttresses concentrate the stone where the structure needs support. Above, flying buttresses arch away from the wall. They carry the thrust of the high vaults through the vertical buttresses to the ground. Bearing no weight, the wall is just a frame for windows. This is the clear story. A skeleton of stone supports the building, framing a lofty interior. As a guide at Chartres for 20 years, Malcolm Miller uses tourists for a simple demonstration of the Gothic skeleton.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And could you come and line up 2 by 2? You come and face him. Feet together. Look at him.
Not very nice.
You face him. You come and face him. Let's imagine that we're inside the cathedral, and these, the backs of our heads, are the wall structure up here between the flying buttresses. Or at least between their heads would be between the flying buttresses. So this is the width of the nave from wall to wall. These gentlemen inside are alternating the 24 great clusters of piers and shafts, and they built them from, let's say, the springer of their heads, transverse arches from head to head like this, built first on wooden support, then moved, taken away. You hope that the stone arch stays up. Then another transverse arch from head to head. So this forms a rectangular section or bay. Next, they built ribs from his head to his head, like this and like that. So each rectangle then is divided into four parts. Quadripartite rectangular vaults. It's one of the Sharp's innovations. Let's do that. Can you make a keystone by holding hands firmly? And you do the same here. You up there, you two here. Up here again, look, no, cross ribs, you with him. Up here and then up there. So, you'll have to imagine, because they don't have three arms, the transverse arches crossing over like this. So this is a rectangular bay, and then these are the four ribs, and where the ribs join, come together, is the keystone. That's an enormous central block in the center of each vault. The vaults themselves are then constructed from arm, not against the wall, but over the wall to the next arm. So if I am the stained glass up there, and the weight is going around me from his arm to his arm, then from his arm to my arm, the transverse arches. So I am, let's pretend, the considerable weight of the stone vaulting inside, spanning what is in fact the widest nave still in France from wall to wall. Are you ready? Okay. I am the weight of the roof. Now, my weight doesn't disappear. It is carried in their arms.
Vaults and ribs together form an interlocking rigid shell that focuses the thrust of its own weight downwards into the piers and outwards through the flying buttresses to the vertical buttresses around the perimeter of the church. This stone scaffolding ensures the stability of the vaults.
One, two, three to either side. I'm the weight of the roof, pushing in the middle of their chests. Girls push back again, make their ribs crack, make them feel it. And my weight is controlled, and look, there's nothing happening here. I can walk in and out of this new structure, the first high Gothic cathedral. The walls may be taken out, theoretically, and stained glass has taken the place. So the invention of flying buttresses, the wall buttress brought up higher, made it possible to build higher, but also to open up the walls, to fill the walls with stained glass, to beautify the building, to instruct the people, and especially to give us the illusion of precious stones, because St. John wrote, "The walls of the heavenly Jerusalem, for which the church is a symbol, are garnished with all manner of precious stones."
Through these windows came a spiritual enlightenment as well. Filled with stories from scripture and moral lessons, the cathedral was an illuminated book for its unlettered congregation, the Bible of the poor. Fragments of colored glass are held in a network of lead, bound together with iron straps. Rough materials combine to create images of extraordinary power. I saw one like unto the Son of Man, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. This is the apocalyptic vision of St. John the Divine, shaped by the medieval glassmaker. I am Alpha and Omega, saith the Lord, the beginning and the end. In less than two centuries, 500 churches and 80 great cathedrals were built in the Gothic style in France alone. It was an unprecedented flowering of architecture and art. Now we can begin to assess the engineering achievement as well. A cathedral's structural frame is modeled for analysis in Robert Mark's laboratory in Princeton. It's been loaded with weights and heated until the softening plastic deformed under the stress caused by the weights. Hardening as it cooled, the distortions were locked into the plastic. The weights simulate the actual loads on the cathedral structure.
We apply loadings, both dead weight and wind loading, that we calculate to affect the real structure, and apply these as scaled loadings to the model. The model is then viewed in polarized light, and the patterns that we see in the light tell us the distribution of forces within the model.
These stress patterns reveal how the cathedral structure really works. It's like a contour map. Where the color changes are closest together, forming dense patterns, the plastic has deformed most under stress. It's there that masonry in the cathedral may be overloaded and crushed, or subject to dangerous tension and cracked. Photographs provide a lasting record for further examination. Robert Mark's assistant is hoping to apply these methods of stress evaluation to the ancient temples of his home country, China. Chartres Cathedral has long been revered as a high point of Gothic beauty. But for engineers, the buttressing system raises questions of efficiency. The pier buttresses are extremely heavy, but they're topped by flying buttresses so light they look like afterthoughts.
This is a model showing the structure of the nave of the cathedral at Chartres. And we tested the model first without and later with these very light buttresses.
The stress contours are analyzed under polarized light.
The flying buttresses below me were thought to have been added at the beginning of the 14th century, because there was a consultant's report on the cathedral which spoke about some work needed on the buttressing. But in fact, our modeling studies have indicated that the flying buttresses have a very small effect on the stability of the building. Our conclusion then is that they were added late in the building, but it was done during the original campaign of construction.
So those flying buttresses were added by the original builders, even though they had no real structural function. On the model, dense contours show that the buttress fails to carry the loading smoothly to the ground. Where the high vault at the right joins the clerestory, there are concentrations of stress. The light flying buttress at the top does little to solve the problem. These findings suggest that the cathedral is overbuilt, an inefficient use of stone by builders who were uncertain and overcautious. But early Gothic buttressing wasn't always so conservative. The cathedral at Bourges was built at the same time as Chartres, but its structure shows extraordinary daring.
The original designer of Bourges may have been the best of the medieval engineers. The buttressing system for his building, which was begun around the same time as Chartres, and which is even slightly taller, weighs only 40% as much as that of Chartres. The achievement was due largely to his aiming the buttresses at a very high angle so that the forces from the clerestory wall were carried more directly to the ground. It wasn't used in any of the other high Gothic buildings, and I think the reason for that is that the designers were frightened. It seemed so light compared to other buildings.
These slender wishbones of stone hold up an entire cathedral. It's a dramatic expression of the potential of Gothic engineering. The model shows how directly the forces are carried down the light buttressing system. This delicate sloping profile is quite different from the rectangular bulk of Chartres Cathedral, where 2.5 times as much stone is used to do the same job. The buttressing at Chartres is extravagant, and it's also under stress, as the swirling contours indicate. At Bourges, smooth contours show how efficiently the light structure works. And once it's pared down to the barest essentials, the rest can be windows. The effect is magical. Stone without weight, space without enclosure. The high vaults seem to float on glass, and everywhere is filled with the bright light of day that to the medieval mind could bring a glimpse of God himself. In its design, the cathedral was supposed to echo the divine proportions of creation itself. Ideally, architecture was governed by the same ratios as music, so that together they could express a universal harmony. A cathedral was pieced together over generations out of a whole society's collaboration. The guilds of tradesmen often donated windows and signed them with a picture. This window at Bourges was the gift of the cathedral builders themselves. In their portrait, they hold the symbols of their trade. With simple tools like these, they built the cathedral stone by stone. Plumb bob, axe, and trowel, and at the top, the master builder with hard hat and compasses. During long years of construction, the building was constantly checked, and the designs revised at any hint of weakness. So the cathedrals themselves served as models for testing new ideas, and the daring Gothic structures grew higher and higher. This is Beauvais, the highest of all the Gothic cathedrals.
This model represents the structure of the Cathedral of Beauvais, which was begun around 1225. The choir, the eastern end of the building, was complete by 1272, and in fact the structure fell in 1284.
Was Beauvais built too high? Its vaults soar 48 meters into the air. In Robert Marks' laboratory, modeling studies have looked for faults in the cathedral's structural design. It was thought that this slender colonnette, attached to the clerestory on the right, caused the collapse by buckling. But the model shows no serious stress concentration here. Instead, the problem seems to have been at the base of this intermediate buttress. Swirling contours suggest dangerous stresses here at the level of the side aisle roof.
There is a very critical region in the intermediate upright, this one right here. And in fact, there was extremely high stresses right down at the base of the upright over the roof. During high winds, the combination of dead weight and high winds would cause a great deal of cracking in that region. The actual upright that failed is the one behind me. That upright, in fact, has been replaced. What you see now is one that was built in the 14th century. The original upright is similar to this one, where there is a relatively light shaft, and it has been reinforced down below. In fact, as one would expect it to be reinforced for the problem that we predicted. It's much heavier along this axis, and they've added a third set of flying buttresses to brace it.
Errors in design were generally corrected during the course of building, but at Beauvais, the danger was concealed by a wooden roof over the side aisle.
the gabled roof behind me, covered the region of the upright so that the masons would not have been able to see the stones undergoing problems from bending. There are traces of that roof behind me as well. You can see it in the stone here and even more clearly in this region. The failure itself took place by the base of the intermediate pier cracking and possibly slipping so that the pier was lowered. It brought the center of the flying buttress down with it, and with the removal of the support for the center of the flying buttress, it fell and allowed the clerestory wall then to burst outward, taking the inner vaults with it.
The choir was rebuilt in the 14th century, strengthened with iron bars. The rest of the cathedral was never completed. Beauvais, it seems, was not a Tower of Babel, tempting heaven with its height. Since it was rebuilt, the lofty structure has stood for nearly six centuries, surviving even the bombs of World War II that smashed the city flat around it. In New York, the cathedral builders are at work again.
This is the Cathedral of St. John the Divine in New York City. It's the largest Gothic-style building in North America. It was begun in the latter part of the 19th century in a different style, in a much heavier Romanesque construction. And after the architect died, it was redesigned in a Gothic mode.
From Romanesque to Gothic, this cathedral reenacts history in its design, and history marked the progress of its construction. Buildings stopped in 1941, the day after Pearl Harbor. The work wasn't taken up again until 1979. Since cathedrals began, they've been in competition with wars. St. John's is being built by hand, using all the traditional methods of working stone. As the mason shapes and levels each block, he leaves a unique pattern with hammer and chisel. It's called boasting, his personal signature on the surface of the stone. James Bambridge is the master builder, overseeing every aspect of construction. He makes a separate full-size plan for every single block, translating it from the architect's drawing. A set of template molds made out of zinc helps to guide the masons as they shape the limestone. Like the master builders of the Middle Ages, James Bambridge was trained as a mason through long years of apprenticeship. Now he's training New Yorkers in the same ancient skills. It's an extraordinary undertaking. In the Mason's Lodge, apprentices from 20th century America emulate the master craftsmen of medieval Europe. The contrast between past and present seems so great. But some things haven't changed at all. These masons, like their predecessors, are building more than just a house of prayer. Then, as now, in a violent and destructive age, the great cathedrals celebrate creation. They speak of human hands that built a lasting beauty, of engineering that gave life to stone and sent it arching upwards.